Last night was our first performance of the Easter program, and they did a phenomenal job. This place was almost packed, and it was pretty amazing to watch so many people that came, and from many of the churches that came and all over, it was very, very well received. And so this morning, I know they're tired, but glad they are here. Did an amazing job. This morning, we are in part two of this series we began last weekend called Heaven, Here and Now. And what we're doing is we're trying to understand what the resurrection of Jesus Christ does for us now, and not just someday in the distant future. Right now, things have changed. The moment you receive Christ as your Savior, there's a resurrection that happens in your life. Heaven has come. And so this morning, we're going to begin in Philippians chapter 3. You can go to the blog and you can follow along, or you can look in your Bibles or follow on the screen. Either way, but let's all stand together, starting in verse 20. Paul says, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. Therefore, my beloved and longed for brethren, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord." Beloved, let's bow our heads in prayer. Holy Spirit, we pray this morning, teach us what it means that we are citizens of heaven. And dear Jesus, we know that right this moment we are seated with you at the right hand of the Father. Teach us to understand how to live life from above, how to live life looking down. Help us this morning. And for those who do not know you, open their eyes that they may see you on that cross, giving your life for them. It's in your name we pray. Let everyone say, you may be seated. Last weekend, in the first message in the series, we learned that we are already resurrected in Christ. We died with him, we were buried with him, and we rose to walk in the newness of life with him. All that is left for us to do is to start living the resurrected life. You're alive. Start living it. This morning, we're going to go one step further in this message. And the message is this: we're not waiting to go to heaven someday when we die. Heaven has already begun in us here and now. We are waiting for Jesus to come and not only transform this place into the new heavens and the new earth, but also transform our lowly body into the glorious body like his. Heaven has begun. Listen to verse 20 again. "For our citizenship is in heaven." What tense is the word is? Present tense. You are already the citizens of heaven. But listen carefully. "From which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." We're not going to go to heaven and wait for him. Right where you are, you're waiting for him to bring the rest of heaven. What if you die before he comes? Are you coming back with him? And your bodies will be transformed too. Let me ask you this morning, what do you believe about heaven? Oh, streets of gold and pearly gates and St. Peter and clouds and You know, sometimes I think we have a lot of ideas and thoughts about heaven that we heard in Sunday school, or we heard from some loved one in the family, or some preacher who said some things, or something on TV, or some prophecy speaker. Let me ask you this morning, what do you believe about heaven that truly squares with this book? You see, this book is our guide. This book, not our ideas. Well, I always heard that growing up. Well, then let it conform to this book. If it doesn't, it's time to cast it away. Let me ask you this morning, is heaven just some place you'll go when you die, or has heaven already begun for you? You see, what you believe about heaven will change how you live on earth right now. This is not just some message in the clouds like, oh yeah, that's a great idea, great thought. It really inspired me. No, it changes the way you live now. It's not in heaven that I will straighten up. In heaven that I will learn how to love sacrificially and completely. And like Jesus, right now you need to love your wife the way you may learn to love her in heaven. Let me ask you this morning, are you looking forward to the coming back of Jesus? Are you looking forward to the transformation that will happen in this world? Are you looking forward to the transformation that's going to happen in your own body? Here's a deeper question. Are you saved? Are you a citizen of earth? Or are you a citizen of heaven? This morning, as we walk through this message, it's a deep message. It's a very deep message. And I pray that if you do not know Christ as your Savior, don't let anything distract you. Don't let anything somebody said about Clearview, or somebody you thought about Clearview, put all that aside. The devil's going to confuse you. The devil's going to distract you. The devil's going to keep you from listening to what the Holy Spirit has for you. Don't miss out. Put down the barriers, put down the walls, and just say, look, I'm here and God is speaking. If it's in the Word, I want to hear it. And if you do not know Christ, my prayer is that you will be saved. So three questions we will understand from this passage about heaven here and now. Question number one, are you growing in Christ and His resurrection? Verse 20, once again, Paul says, for our citizenship is in heaven. Now, before we try to understand what Paul is talking about, we need to understand the context in which he wrote those words. You have to back up to Philippians chapter 3 and verse 2. Paul says, beware of dogs. He's not talking about Sparky, okay, a Rover. What he's talking about are the Judaizers who were trying to confuse the Christians. Not the Jewish people, but the Judaizers. These were people who said, yeah, we need Jesus, but you also need the Sabbath. You also need the dietary laws. You also need the rituals and the traditions and the purifications and the circumcision. Paul says they're nothing but dogs. And by the way, to call somebody dogs in the Jewish culture was very, very low down, degrading. And then he also says to them, evil workers. He doesn't say, oh, those people are misguided. He said, no, they're evil. Beware of the mutilation. I mean, you don't need much imagination to know what he's talking about. He's talking about the circumcision. He said, watch out for these people. And then he says in verse 3, for we are the circumcision. We are the real deal, who worship God in the Spirit. It's not worshiping Him in all these rituals and traditions. We worship God in the Spirit. Isn't that what Jesus talked about to the Samaritan woman? Rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Meaning Christ has fulfilled all the requirements. Rejoice in Him, worship Him in the Spirit, and do not take pride in all the things that you do and all the rituals you got and all the traditions you got. Put it away. Paul even says, let me give you, you think you got a list of credentials? I got some credentials. Credential number one, I was circumcised the eighth day. I am the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a Pharisee, a persecutor of the church. You want to try me? I'm way more than them, but I have learned Those things don't matter. Those rituals, those traditions, those credentials are worthless. And then listen to what he says in verse 7. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. The word for loss is a mistranslation. The word is zemia in Greek, which literally means damaging. What I thought was going to help me, it actually became damaging to me. It was disadvantageous to me. It hurt me. It was not good for me. It was not good for my growth in Christ. Let me ask you this morning, what are you holding on to? Oh, I don't believe in circumcision and all that stuff. I don't. Are you holding on to church traditions? I'm just old-fashioned that way. I just, that's just me. Let me ask you this. Are those things keeping you in your growth in Christ? Do you have to fight them to grow in Christ? Then something is wrong with this. Sometimes people come to me and talk about all the traditions and rules. I can assure you, I grew up with a whole lot more traditions than any of y'all did. But our church changed. My dad changed his focus and focused more on Christ and the resurrection. It radically changed all of us. It brought life. So when you talk about traditions and rituals, let me ask you a question. Ever since you've come to Clearview, have you grown in Christ? There's a reason for that. You see, those things are damaging. It's not just a loss. I miss those things. Have you heard people say that? I miss those. I miss that song. Or I miss these. No, those are damaging sometimes. Let me give an illustration. I'm embarrassed to give this illustration, but I'll do it. Until I was about 4.5 years of age, I drank my milk bottle. I really did. It's embarrassing. I didn't want to let go of that bottle. I really didn't. Nicole knows this, and this morning, the first service heard it for the first time. What happened was we had a lot of nurses in our church growing up. We had a railway hospital, and railways are big, so huge hospital. And nurses, traveling nurses and all that, they would come, Christian nurses would come, and they would come to our church, and they would love it. And my dad was an amazing preacher, and these girls would come, and they were like, man, we're getting fed. Many of them actually made our home, our town their hometown. They settled because of the church. And I remember one day, this nurse came into our house before church, I guess to pick up Sunday school literature or something. I really don't remember. But I was ready to go to church. I was about 4.5 years old. I had a tie on, nice shoes, tied them nice. And mommy said, here's your bottle. And I took my bottle, laid it down on the couch, and stuck it, okay? And I was just working on it. Lo and behold, this nurse walks in. What is the boy doing? Mom said, well, he's, you know. No, he should not be drinking from a bottle. It'll be a couple of months before he goes to kindergarten. No, and that's not good for him. Take that away from him now. It is bad for him. Mom's like, well, you know, he's, you know, we're hoping before school. No, right now, you need to take that away from him. And sure enough, my mom listened to her, this mean woman, and she took the bottle away. 15 minutes later, we're sitting in church. I turned back, and I saw her. I glared at her throughout the whole service. I hate you. Who gives you the right to come and take away my milk bottle? You don't know. I was having breakfast. Folks, if it wasn't for her, I would still have a milk bottle. When those rituals are taken away, those things are pried out of our hands, it hurts. You glare. Sometimes I see people glaring at me. But here's the test. I cannot eat meat and potatoes. I cannot eat what is healthy for me. If you still hang on to this here, it's damaging your spiritual life. Listen to what Paul declares in verse 8. Yet indeed, I also count all things, what's the word? Loss, which is really damaging, disadvantages, for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, and be found in him. Not only do I want his knowledge, knowledge means I want to be in Christ. If you look for me, find me in Jesus. I died with him, I was buried with him, and I rose to walk in the newness of life with him. Then he says in verse 10, Paul, what are you looking for? That I may know him. And the power of his resurrection, meaning I am not satisfied. I want to understand more about this resurrection that has happened in my heart. See, the moment you got saved, did you know that resurrection life has already come into your heart? It is spiritual. It is invisible. You can't see it, but it's right here. The grave is alive. It's open. And you're alive. But listen to what he says. He said, I'm not finished yet. There's another resurrection coming in verse 11. If by any means I may attain the resurrection from the dead. So he said, I got this resurrection, which is inward and spiritual. But I'm also looking for the resurrection that is outward and physical. I'm looking forward to the day when Jesus will come and not only make the new heavens and the new earth, but that he'll also change this lowly body and make it into one like his glorious body. Let me ask you this morning, what is damaging your spiritual growth? You know, sometimes people say, oh, this message is deep. Yes, it is deep. But I think many of y'all have been sitting in ankle-deep water. Every time you go to the swimming pool of spirituality and Christian growth and the Bible, all you do is you run to the kiddie pool and you sit over there and you say, I got Jesus. That's about it. The purpose is to go deep, go deep. That's where you learn how to swim. And when the storms of life come, you don't panic, you don't go down. You go, I can swim. So I know the message is deep, and I know it's different, but this is biblical. Is it not coming from the Bible? It's the Word of God. Paul says, what I want to do is know Christ and the power of his resurrection inwardly, but I'm also trying to attain the resurrection from the dead. I want more. Let me ask you this morning, is this your desire? Or would Paul put you in the category with dogs? Evil workers. Are you growing in the knowledge of Christ? Are you found in Christ? Are you dead, buried, and resurrected in Christ and looking forward to the rest of it? But here's number two. Are you pressing toward the total transformation to come? Not only are you growing in Christ and his resurrection, but are you pressing toward the total transformation to come? Listen to what it says in verse 11. If by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. We just read that, but now go on to verse 12. Not that I have already attained. Cut me and I'll bleed. These eyes, I can't see like I used to. Back hurts, knee hurts. I know I haven't attained, but, or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Now, I know typically that message is preached on New Year's Eve. I preached it too. I press on, leave the past behind, and press on. But in the context, I don't think he is really talking about leaving your past behind and pressing on to a brighter, greener pasture. What Paul is talking about is leave all your traditions and rituals and man-made rules behind and press on to the resurrection to come. Press on to Jesus. Press on to what is waiting for you. The upward call means one day there's a call coming and Jesus is going to say, you guys ready? Here we go. Everything is transformed. And then listen to what he says again in verse 20. For our citizenship is in heaven. Again, Paul does not say, I can't wait to go to heaven. He does not say, I wonder what heaven's going to be like. Have you heard people say, I wonder what it's going to be like? Folks, he says, I'm already there. And guess what? The rest of us is coming very soon. from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, to come and bring the rest of heaven. Folks, do you know that this creation, God's going to remake it? Go walk outside and look. This is going to be the new heavens and new earth. The new heavens and new earth is not up in the clouds somewhere far, far away, streets of gold and gates of pearl. It's coming down here. But that's, I always heard, read the Bible, find me what the Bible says about heaven. What Paul says about it. And when he comes, he will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. You see, Paul is reminding the Philippians that we are to look forward to the day. We need to press towards the day. Remember he says in verse 13, same context, he said, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal." See, the goal is the resurrection to come. The goal is when all this will be remade. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. There'll be a shout. And my name is going to be called. And every name will be called. Wow, here it comes. You see, Paul has his letter of heavenly citizenship. I'm already a citizen of heaven. What he wants to do is go through the swearing-in ceremony and become a full-fledged citizen. Ten-plus years ago, I began the process of my citizenship. I had to go through a lengthy process, paperwork, had to take an exam, interview, and U.S. history, U.S. geography, politics. And you know how I study things, man. I delved into it like it was my dissertation and sat in the interview, and the guy finally goes, "Shucks, you know more than I do about this stuff." I said, "Well, I've been studying about U.S. history all my life, and this is very important to me." Many of y'all, it's by accident you're a U.S. citizen. But for me, it was a choice. And next to being saved and marrying Nicole, this is the best thing I ever did. Really, to become an American citizen. I'm very proud of it. And I remember getting this paper in the mail saying, "You are, for all practical purposes, you have all the rights and privileges of being an American citizen. Here's the date for your swearing-in ceremony. Be there." I think it was like 8 o'clock in the morning. "If you can't, let us know." Which means you're already done, but make sure you're here. But if you're not, you still have it. Well, I wasn't going to miss this. I wanted to go and do the real deal. I remember that morning getting there and getting to that place and 50, 60 people in that place, and we got there. To me, it was very special. People were laughing, joking, talking, families there. To me, it was very, very humbling. And then we took the pledge, and I remember walking out of that place just feeling a sense of pride and humility at the same time. This country has given me the privilege of being one of them. That the heritage of this country is now my heritage. The founding fathers are my founding fathers. That was a very special day. The paper said it all, but the swearing-in ceremony completed the process. What Paul is saying is, I got the paper, but what I'm looking forward to is that day when I will get the rest of it. I remember that morning seeing those, we went by some restaurant, pick up some biscuit or something, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And you know, some of the restaurants, you know, the veterans, bunch of guys, they'll gather and they'll have their biscuit and coffee. That's the place. And it happened to be one of those places. And I saw these veterans sitting there, you know, hats on, World War II, Korean War, whatever. And I thought to myself, I owe it to them. These are the men who fought for my freedom. Folks, there was a difference in the way I saw things. What Paul is saying here is the same thing. You have the letter of heavenly citizenship, but it's time to go on, to press towards the day when you actually are sworn in. But there's something more than just a swearing in. It's a transformation that is coming. Let me ask you this morning. there are three kinds of people in this place. The first are the people who are content with playing with rituals and traditions. And if you are in that stage, one or two options. You're either lost or you're really dead. You need to get saved. You are the dogs and evil workers that Paul is talking about. The second kind of people in this place are people who are saved, but they're simply satisfied with their spiritual transformation. Well, I remember the day I got saved. That's about it. I love Jesus and I'm looking forward to heaven. And if that's all you are, it's time to press on. And that's the third group of people. These are people who are spiritually resurrected in Christ, but they're not satisfied. They're looking forward to the physical resurrection to come. Heaven is not someplace far away. It's already begun. We're just waiting for our new clothes to arrive. Let me ask you this morning, which one are you? Which one are you? Scripture is clear. Press on. Folks, Christ may come today. He may come 100 years from now. He may come 1,000 years from now. We may die before he comes. Either way, there's a transformation coming. Are you looking forward to that? Now, here's question number three. How are you living now in light of the future? See, a message like this, man, that was interesting. I never thought of it that way. That's got me thinking. That's not the purpose of this message. This is not a novel idea. This is not something just different. There's something happens now. Does your future transformation transform how you live in the present? The fact that you are pressing toward the full resurrection of the body, does that change the way you live in your home? Does that change the way you live in your community? Does that change the way you think about church? It should. Seven things very quickly, Paul says. Number one, chapter 4, verse 1, he said, therefore, what does therefore mean? Because of all that I told you, therefore, my beloved and longed for brethren, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord. I didn't put all the references up there, but it's in your Bibles. It's in the outline. It's on the blog. Paul says, stand firm in the truth, knowing what is coming. You know some Christians, they're always blown about here. Next thing you know, they're here. Problems come to all of a sudden, they're here. All disheveled. Don't know what's going to happen. Paul says, you know what's going to happen. Stay strong. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Stay firm on his truth. What else? Be a peacemaker and not a pot stirrer. You know what pot stirrers are? They stir the pot. Always can get something going. Listen to what Paul says. I implore Judea and I implore Syntyche. See what we've done is we take this out of context and we say, oh, this is how you resolve conflict. No, this is all in the context of your future resurrection. Therefore, I implore Judea and Syntyche, two women, by the way, who were very prominent in the church, he said, to be of the same mind in the Lord. And I urge you also, true companion, help these women who labor with me in the gospel. Means you know Jesus is coming soon. You know he's going to change all these things. In the meantime, when you see people misunderstanding and miscommunicating and in conflict, don't take secret pleasure in that. Don't walk away smiling and going and cutting your eyes and going, I got something going over there. No, you help make things right. You help them get along. It's like many of y'all are farmers. You know what I'm talking about. You got work to do. You got bills to pay. You got seeds to buy. And you put your workers out in the field and you tell them, hey guys, I need this done. And they start fussing and fighting with each other. By the way, we had a farmer in our last service and he came to me and said, man, you have no idea. This day itself, I had to fire two guys. Been with me for years. I had to let them go. Because here I told them, guys, I want you to work. I got to go do these things. And they were fussing. And I told them, listen, stop. And they continued, didn't do the work. I had to let them go. Jesus is coming soon. He will transform everything. And yet you are here. You can't get along. Be a peacemaker, not a pot stirrer. What's number three? Rejoice in every situation. Rejoice in the Lord always. Verse 4, again, I will say rejoice. No matter what's happening, good times, bad times, things are not working out, home is not right, children are not where they need to be, rejoice. You know Jesus is coming. You know he's going to make everything right. You know it'll be all right. Here's number 4. Be gentle when people fail you. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. You see, the context is still evolving. It hasn't left. It's like when we leave our home, go on a date night. We don't have to do that as much anymore. We would get on to the kids and say, if we come home and find y'all fussing and fighting, all of y'all going to get it. Y'all know what I'm talking about. All y'all going to get it. I mean, there is not going to be, well, he started it or she. No, everybody's going to get it. So guess what they do? Before they know, 8:30, they're going to be home soon. They make things right. You all right? I'm all right. Okay, everybody's good? Okay, good. Gentle with each other. Knowing that Jesus is coming soon. What's number 5? It says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. What we typically do is we take this right out of the context and talk about how we need to pray. No, it's in the context of Christ bringing our heavenly clothes. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Don't panic. Just pray. Some of us are in panic mode right now, and when we're in panic mode, we do things that we regret. You're already resurrected. The rest of it is coming. We're not going someplace. We're coming back here. He's going to make all things new. Don't panic. He's in control. No matter what you're saying, God is still on his throne. And he will work all things together for good in your life, in my life, in our families, in this church. He will work it out. Just pray. Here's number 6. Focus on the good. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. How many of y'all like to be around pessimistic, negative people? None of us. When you know that Jesus is coming, he's going to make everything right and give us the rest of us, why are you focused on the negative? I tell you, the world is a mess right now. Well, okay. Jesus is in control. I don't know how the elections are going to turn out. Well, I don't either. I hope they turn out right. We'll do our best to make sure we do our part. Having said that, whatever things are pure, good, lovely, focus on them. Focus on the positive. And here's number 7. Be content. Paul says, therefore, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound everywhere in all things. I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And then he says, I can do all things through Christ who? Typically, athletes put that on their back. I can do all things through Christ as I dunk that ball. I can do all things through Christ as I bring on that home run. Paul is not talking about that. He's not talking about home runs and dunking the basketball. He is talking about, look, right now I know I'm hungry, but I know I'll be full. Right now I'm in need, but I know he will meet my needs. I have learned to be content. Being content does not mean not having any ambitions and goals in life. Folks, we need ambitions, right? We need goals in life. We need a vision, whether in your own personal life, for your children, for this church, for our nation. We need a vision. He's not talking about not having a vision. What he's saying is, listen, no matter what's happening, I am content. I'm okay. Because everything will be okay. And I know this message is hard for some of us. Because right now you're facing a situation where you go, I want to have peace, but I don't seem to have peace in my heart. I'm going through this problem, I'm going through this situation, this relationship, this children, work, church. I just don't have it. Turn to Jesus. In everything, by prayer and supplication, let your request be made known with thanksgiving. Thank Him for what He's done for you. He'll take care of it. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will do what? Will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. You see, what you believe about heaven changes how you live on earth. Would you stand together? Jesus, we look to you this morning. We look to you in anticipation. And this morning, Holy Spirit, we pray that you would open our eyes of faith, that we may see our Lord bringing the rest of heaven with Him. What has begun in our hearts will be completed very soon in our bodies and in this creation. Transform our thinking right now. Help us, oh God, to focus on the positive. Help us, dear Lord, that when we see people in contention, that we will be peacemakers, not posturers. Help us this morning, God, to stand firmly in the truth. Help us this morning, God, to be content. Holy Spirit, you know exactly where all of us are. Speak to us in Jesus' name. As we sing, the altar is open. You come pray.